fall of the worlds. It was the war to end all wars. There was no one left to fight. No war memorials. No wall with the names of the dead. No statues of heroes. Only empty cities and the ruins of great civilizations on two planets. Tumbleweeds, skulls, crows. Only in Zalem did the light stay on. Who attacked first? It doesn't matter. Once it starts, there is always a wrong which needs to be righted. Always an attack which needs to be avenged. Memory is short, hatred is long, and truth is the first casualty. Humanity's failure is that it started. Our past began as one. Humans looked outward, founding colonies among the stars. Earth and Mars were the interplanetary superpowers. Man was leaping for the stars, driven not by nobility, but greed. Greed that consumed the parent worlds, pitting Mars and its interstellar colonies against Imperial Earth. And they went to war. Not a war for independence, but a war for all the marbles. Two civilizations, linked by history, but alien to each other, incompatible, and fighting for the same resources. There were two planets throwing rocks at each other like little kids. But such rocks they threw. In the grand expansion across the galaxies, man had mastered matter and energy and time itself, but learned no wisdom and found no peace. For with the mastery of matter and energy came fearsome weapons. Alita was born at this moment in history. An innocent human child brought to life on Mars. She was called Yoko until the war between the planets destroyed her home and family. She was plucked for action by the Urm war machine, her brain installed in a basic titanium core and a no-frills cyborg body for adaptation and training. She was only 17. By the time her brain was transplanted into a Class 1 Urm Berserker-compatible core, she had been identified as a high-value military asset, armed with the ultimate in 21st century cyborg technology. What role was this 17-year-old girl to play in the battle between Earth and Mars? Was she good then? Was she evil? Was she the Urm's instrument of destruction? The endgame of the war came with a bioweapon penetrating Earth's defenses. Humans were dying, and the spread was unchecked. Defensive action was taken, but there were no means to contain something of this magnitude. The Sky City of Zalem was sealed to prevent the virus from getting in. While the disease spread around the globe, a viral tidal wave that quickly surpassed any efforts to quell the devastation. Mortality rates rose to 70%. There was carnage in the streets. Poor and powerful alike died by the millions and lay unburied. Zalem above watched as the lights of the world went out. Returning freighters and warships were turned away for fear of contamination. Some took their chances descending to the infected planet below. Others just ran out of time and went dark. The enemy grew quiet as well. The nanobot plague counterstrike on Mars had found its mark. Refugees from every place on Earth converged on Iron City under the shadow of Zalem. Isolated from the plague, the Zalans ruled the world. The surface people grew their food and worked their factories. In return, they gave them power, medicine, technology, and the rule of law. It was a cruel system, but the beacon of Zalem gave hope for the future. The rest of the world was reclaimed by nature. The great cities collapsed and were overrun by forest. There were pockets of humanity, sometimes in the ruins of cities, sometimes in small towns and villages. They struggled with disease and starvation. Those who could do so journeyed to Iron City. Thus, Zalem has endured for 3 centuries. The world is at peace, a rigidly enforced one. There is no growth and no progress. Though life on the ground is mired in squalor, the Zalans float above, isolated and serene. Unaware of a lonely cyborg core, a warrior of the forgotten war, discarded in the scrap, life still blinking within, ready to rise again.
sugar levels up.
Taste receptors are working. Thank you. You'll like this a whole lot better with the peel off.
I don't mean to be rude, but if I'm supposed to know you...
Actually, we haven't met. I'm Dr. Dyson Edo, Nurse Gerhard.
Do you know who I am?
Well, we were hoping you'd fill in that part. Since you're a total replacement cyborg, and most of your cyber body was destroyed, we can't find any records. But your very human brain was miraculously intact. Theoretically, you should remember something.
Oh. Well, it's still pretty blank. No, it's completely blank, actually. I don't even know my own name.
Let's look at the bright side.
Your tears are working.
That's so good. What do you call this?
My secret place. Best view in town.
Wow. Really cool.
No. Look. That view.
Oh. Right. I wonder what it's like up there.
Better than this dump down here. Listen. Stuff from the factory going up to Zalem. But the tubes are just for cargo, not for people. If I was as strong as you, I'd climb that tube to Zalem right now.
They don't let anybody up there.
Yeah, that's what they want you to think. You just gotta know the right people. I happen to be connected.
Oh.
You gotta be willing to do what it takes. Whatever it takes. Funny thing is, you've seen it. You just can't remember.
What do you mean?
Doc found you in the scrapyard. All that stuff is dumped from Zalem. So you must be from up there.
I guess so.
If you could just tell me what those eyes have seen.
I wish I could. I keep trying to remember, but it's still a blank. I'm starting to feel like I wasn't very important. Just an insignificant girl thrown out with the rest of the garbage.
Get it? I won't do it.
But you have to. This would help us fight Gruishka and anyone else he sends after us. This body, it has the power I need. I feel a connection to it. I can't explain. This could be who I am.
You've
been given a chance to start over with a clean slate. How many of us get that
chance? Why did an enemy warship respond to me? Because I knew that ship. I've been on others like it, haven't I? Haven't I?
Oh, whatever you were, it's not who you are now. No.
I'm a warrior, aren't I? And you know. You've always known.
This is called a berserker. It's a humanoid weapon system created by the Urm Technarchy. Your core was designed to interface with this type of body. Your identity code activated it. The instinctive fighting technique you use is Panzerkunst, a lost combat art for machine bodies. It was used by the berserkers. This is where you're drawn to conflict without hesitation. It's part of your training. You are not just a warrior, Alita. You're an Urm Berserker, the most advanced cyborg weapon ever created. And that is exactly why I will never unite you with this body.
That's fine.
What brings you in here, sweets? Come to see the hunters up close?
Not exactly.
Cupcake here's a bounty hunter. So you went down, you filled out your application forms, you got your ID badge, and now you're just like us, yeah? Let me introduce you to some of your professional colleagues. This is Master Clive Lee of the White Hot Palm. He has over 200 confirmed kills.
207.
Well, and this is Screwhead, one of our most lethal bounty hunters. And then there's McTeague.
The Dog Master.
With his hellhounds. His biggest problem is having enough left to identify after so he can collect the bounty. Oh, and then there's me. Zapan. Keeper of the legendary Damascus Blade. Honed to a monomolecular edge, it slices armor like butter. Forged before the fall by the lost arts of Urm metallurgy.
And who did you kill to acquire it?
A hunter warrior is a solitary predator. You'll be competing against us for the kill. You can see what you're up against.
Thanks. I came to ask for your help against our common enemy. Gruishka. He's being protected by the system and continues to rampage unchecked. And now he's after Ito and me. So I'm calling on you, my hunter warrior brothers. Let's band together and defeat him once and for all.
Any takers? Hmm? No? Big surprise. You know, normally I wouldn't take a rookie under my wing. Share my knowledge. I'm willing to make an exception in your case. If you cut loose, meat boy over here, and let me buy you a drink.
Hey, watch it.
And What could I learn from a loudmouth pretty boy who spends all of his money on his face?
Maybe I'll pull your arms and legs off. Roll your head around in the street. Maybe that'll teach you some manners.
You might mess up your hair.
This is Iron City. I spent my whole life here dreaming of being somewhere else. I'm the guy that can get you what you need. You work in my business, you have to know the streets. Which ones have to bury treasure, and which ones to stay out of. Barrio Purgatorio. This is Workers' Town. You live, you die, you never get ahead. I was one of those kids playing motorball over there. A lot of families around here. Watched my dad work himself into an early grave. Wasted limbs replaced by cyborg parts. Turning himself into a machine. The scrapyard. I come here all the time. You never know what you can find. Mostly I like to think about what life is like in Zalem. All this garbage comes from right up there. Factory District. This is the big industrial part of town. There's warehouses, factories, not much else. There are people who live here too. Rough crowd. Street gangs, cheap bars, the lowest rent in town. A lot of stuff you don't want to know about happens in the nighttime around here. Working people have strange appetites. Barrio Viejo, lost splendor right here. Makes you wonder what this place was like before the fall. It's all built over now. Doc Ito's place used to be a casino. There are apartments on top of apartments, restaurants, street markets. I like being here. I like the energy. I like the bustle of people. Barrio Oscuro. It's known as the Shadow Quarter, but there's no great mystery. Just the most hours of darkness under Zalem. I'll be honest, it's pretty depressing. There are factories, there's apartments. Workers live here when they can't afford much else. Corazon de Acero, heart of steel. Good place to get in trouble. When I was young, we used to whisper secrets about coming here when we got old enough. The rowdiest place of all is the Kansas Bar. That's where the Hunter Warriors hang out. And anybody who wants to lose a limb in a bar fight. Barrio Latino. This is the Latin Quarter. Everybody speaks Spanish. After the fall, all the people left from South America, Central America, they ended up here. They still run the place. Barrio Asiatico. This is the Asian Quarter. Chinatown, Koreatown, Little Tokyo. Pretty flashy place. Too many people and you get a headache from all the signs. The food's good, though. Medina. The Islamic section between Claro and the scrapyard. Also contains the African street market. Motorball Arena. This is where the action happens. The superstars of Iron City all play right here. Josh Ugan, Ajakuddy. You should see this place when it's lit up for the big game. 300,000 people screaming in unison. Life isn't pretty down here in Iron City. It's messy, human, noisy. You do what it takes to survive. But you know, you look up at the great Sky City and that's a promise of hope. Right there, just out of reach. Down here, you don't make much, but it's real. Just watch out for the dark corners.
They say that on the last night of the old world, the sky cities fell and the earth shook. They say the war ended when there wasn't anybody left to claim victory. Anyway, all we know is the Urm never came again from beyond the sky. Whoever was left came to the only place where the lights were still on. The last of the great sky cities. Zalem. The refugees down below Zalem built a town, and the town became Iron City. Nice place. It was built by the dregs of humanity over the junk of a fallen empire. The Hydro Wall. Some say it protects us, but I say it's just there to keep us inside. We live in the shadow of Zalem. Under Zalem, night comes early. In Iron City, you serve Zalem or you don't live very long. For most people, that means you work for the factory. Zalem runs the factory, and the factory runs the town. Pretty much everything we make goes up the tube to the Sky People, so they can live in luxury up there above the clouds. In return, they drop their garbage, a steady stream. We scavenge like rats. That's the way things were when she fell. The one they call the Battle Angel. I just know her as Alita.
You're alive.
Sleepyhead, am I supposed to know you?
Just tell me what you remember.
Nothing. Nothing at all. I don't even know my name.
We'll make up a name. How's that? You can live here with me. You'll always have a home, Alita.
Who am I? I'm going out.
Alita, just wait. Remember, the streets of Iron City aren't safe.
You always say that.
Just listen to me. Everybody out there's got something to prove or nothing to lose. In Iron City, evil always finds its true form. I'm sorry I didn't bring you into a better world, Alita.
Dad, I'll be okay. Promise. I'm just going out to play motorball with the kids.
Be careful. And don't lose your feet.
Hey, nice wheels.
Thanks. That's a nice bike.
Man, you're intense when you play. You want to go for a ride?
Okay.
Hop on. I'm Hugo.
Where are we going?
Trust me, you'll like it.
You bring a lot of girls up here?
Hundreds. Actually, you're the first. Best view in Iron City. Feels like I can reach up and touch it. You see over there? That's where the Sky Bridge fell back in the war. Once the lower world was connected back before the fall and you could go up. But now, nobody ever goes up. They say it was the ladder to the stars, whatever that means. And there were ships that flew above the sky. Man, I'd love to see that. Hey, you came from up there. You can tell me about it when you get your memory back.
Hugo, I'm just an insignificant girl. They threw me away like the rest of the garbage.
And what a combination! Double spin kick from Aja Cuddy sends Claymore into the boards!
Damn, check it out. That's the Proconsul. He's the big dog down here in the lower world.
We will hunt down the enemies of freedom, and we will destroy
destroy the insurgents wherever they hide.
Those are the paladins. The pretty face is Gruishka. And that's his girlfriend, Nissiana, mean as a snake. Uh-oh. Come on, it's gonna get ugly.
Halt! Violation! Do not resist!
The factory does not own my soul.
Factory code violation, section 1162.4. The penalty is death. Execution authorized. Weapons enabled.
There's something stronger than you. It's called freedom.
I'll set you free. Execute command.
No!
I want you to rip her apart and make the parts small.
I didn't know insurgents were so cute.
Alita, run!
No, I'm gonna kick this bitch's ass.
That little bitch is mine! Nobody touches her but me.
The girl is an Urm berserker.
The Urm? That's bullshit. The Urm have been dead for 300 years.
Apparently not.
Well, whoever I am, I'm sure not Daddy's little China doll.
Look, if you're from the war, then this ship is from your time, right? So I figured maybe something in it would trigger your memory.
That's your big idea?
Well, it's a little thin.
If this is an Urm ship, why is it responding to me?
You know why. This is an Urm berserker shell. It is your destiny. A warrior's spirit needs a warrior's body.
I'm not some doll for you to play with.
Oh shit, Gruishka.
Looking for me?
Nissiana was the only thing I ever loved!
Alita, run!
Welcome to the underworld, sweetie. My turf now. I was born here.
And you're gonna die here.
Let me show you the quality of my mercy.
Bring it. Fuck your mercy.
God. Alita! Save her, Doc, please! Whatever it takes!
What's happening?
It's adaptive nanotechnology. The shell is reconfiguring to her subconscious image of herself.
Looks like our little girl's older than we thought.
She's the last bullet fired from the last gun of a dead, forgotten world. And she is coming for you.
Wow, you look different.
I am different. I can do anything a real girl can do.
Anything?
There is a dragon inside her, a hatred you cannot comprehend. Only one thing keeps it leashed.
I give you my heart, Hugo.
Damn, you're intense.
Double spin kick from Aja Cuddy sends Claymore into the boards. And it's Joshigan coming up with the ball on the inside. It's the Crimson Wind breaking out of the pack. Next up is second league tryouts. Factory practice team report to the line. Looks like there's only one prospect tonight, folks. Give it up for Alita!
Alita, it's a setup. Those aren't gladiators. They're hired killers.
Which ones?
All of them.
Keep watching. Maybe a little motorball will break out in the middle of this fight.
Come on. I'm right here.
What a kick combination! The new kid Alita is really taking names out there. This action is hotter than the playoffs. Looks like the fans have got themselves a new darling. With the face of an angel and a body built for battle.
Alita, it's me. They found us. I've got paladins tracking us.
I'm coming.
Alita!
Stop! No!
Your time is long past, little girl. Your world is dead. Your people forgotten. Time to join them.
Touch him again, I'll kill you.
Don't you know who I am?
You are Antioch, ruler of the lower worlds. And I am an insignificant girl. But you will not leave here alive.
The last of the mighty Urm warriors, is that the best you can do?
You shouldn't pick on girls. It's all right, Hugo. I've got you.
Well, I lived. But man, waking up was sure a shock. Doc, what did you do? Alita, wait!
Go back, Hugo. I remember everything. I was sent to destroy Zalem. I'm finishing the mission.
Don't die, please. I love you.
Jump! Hugo! Don't worry, I've got you.
Can we go down now, please? And so it began. The legend of the Battle Angel. The girl who came down from the sky to destroy the world, but instead chose to save it. That's my baby.
Time to shake the pillars of heaven.
It takes time to adjust to your new life. There's no going back. After a few years, you won't even remember your old body. Things that used to be important, well, they aren't anymore. Being lethal is so much more rewarding. What does it mean to be a cyborg? Well, it's all about perspective, isn't it? Here are some things you'll never have to worry about again. Most diseases, loss of hearing or sight, body odor, bad breath, dandruff, toe jam, runny nose, sore muscles, farts, burps, vomits, hitting your funny bone, coughing, lung cancer, broken bones, diarrhea, heart attack. All a thing of the past. I'm a hunter warrior, a bounty hunter. I work on commission, but that doesn't mean I don't enjoy it.
Bounty for the cyborg was 20,000 credits.
Things you still need to worry about are eating. For the curious, it all gets collected in a waste bag. You can eat as much as you like, just bring extra trash liners. Drinking, about half a litre a day will do. Eliminating your waste. Same deal. Girls squat, boys stand, but go wild, rig it up however you like. Everyone's got their special mods. Breathing, fear, aging, memory loss, insanity, dementia, death. You are not immortal.
Bounty for the cyborg was 20,000 credits.
Yeah, some new things to worry about. Reduce sensation. Things just... they just don't feel the same. There's power failure, loss of lubricant, loss of hydraulic fluids, jackers. Yeah, they'll strip you of your valuable parts. Unless I strip them first. Strong magnetic fields, high voltages, system viruses, and they are deadly.
Bounty for 20,000 credits.
Mod addiction. Yes, the need to upgrade your body is very satisfying. And what can I say? It's the best thing I've ever done. I look any way I want, and I choose to look like a god.
Battle Angel is about a girl who is plopped into the world not knowing who she is or what she is.
Do you know who I am?
We were hoping you'd fill in that part.
She thinks she's just an insignificant girl, so she goes on this journey in order to find out who she is and discover what she is, and discovers that she's not an insignificant girl at all. She is someone actually quite extraordinary.
She represents, I think, a certain kind of female empowerment that we need in films. It's an empowerment of her internal psychological and spiritual character. I like Alita because she's absolutely fearless. It doesn't matter how big the opponent is or how powerful or how menacing, she just goes right at it.
If anybody asks me about the timing of making Alita, it's not the technology that was so important. It was finding Rosa Salazar to play the character of Alita.
Rosa Salazar is fantastic. I mean, she is our greatest asset, I think, on this movie.
It's amazing when you're doing casting and you're hoping the actor walks in and it's the character. It's a real gift when that happens, and it just so happened that way on this.
Rosa came in and auditioned for Robert, and he said to us that Rosa actually made him cry.
She ran the gamut of it in such a way that I was totally affected.
Don't do this. Don't leave me down here. Not for that.
I kind of put together several scenes so you could see them, from the innocent little girl to the love scene with the boy meeting him, some father-daughter scenes, and then her realizing who she is.
And ultimately, we set up an old-fashioned screen test.
I don't mean to be rude, but am I supposed to know you?
And when we just watched the footage back on the big screen, there was no question of who was born to play Alita other than Rosa Salazar.
And she just started to emerge out in front of everybody. An actor who put such heart, such emotion, and such vitality into every moment.
You're the only one who sees me for who I really am. We're the same, Hugo.
It was the best gift we could have gotten, and it's the kind of gift you're still very thankful for. This would have been so difficult otherwise. Her humanity comes out, and she emotes so well that it makes the character super relatable. You have to believe in this character and believe she exists, and it's just realer than real.
Starting to feel like I wasn't very important. Just an insignificant girl thrown out with the rest of the garbage.
Gave Rosa the part. It was a good 5 to 6 months before we went into production. And Rosa, from that day forward, dedicated herself to playing Alita. She trained in martial arts. She trained in rollerblading. She trained whenever we asked her to do anything.
Oh, that did look good. When I walked in there for the first time, I was made out of croissants. So I was not her yet. A lot of it was getting the endurance up, toning my body, changing my diet, becoming a very regimented person. And it was great for the character because Alita was trained as a warrior. She has a warrior's mind, she has a warrior's body, she has a warrior's endurance. The training almost killed me. I worked really closely for 4.5 months with Keith Cook Hirabayashi, who is a very, very talented martial artist. We did 2 hours every day. We did a lot of kicks. We did a lot of Muay Thai. We did a lot of Kung Fu, Eagle Claw. We did kickboxing.
When she came in, she was this whirlwind. She wanted to do everything herself. She didn't want to just go in there and have to look good for camera. She wanted to be good for martial artists.
From skating to fighting, the poses to reactions. We wanted to make her action second nature so that she could just focus on her character, and then the reactions and the body movement would have been just there.
So she went over there and she learned weapons, she learned open hand combat, she learned all sorts of other things. Everyone had to get their Rollerblade 101 down. Rosa did a great job.
It takes a lot of girls to bring Alita to life. It takes about 9 girls. I'm doing all of the acting and I'm doing what I can do, martial arts-wise. But then there are other girls who take it from there, who can twirl through the air 6 times, who can contort their bodies because they've been doing it since birth. They really take it to the next level.
The biggest challenge of this film, from a design standpoint, was the character of Alita herself.
We take a lot of the design straight from the book, and the look of Alita straight from the book.
Alita, in our movie, has 3 bodies. She starts out in what we call the doll body, and that is a body that is about innocence and how Alita first comes into this world. We went through a very lengthy design process of the character, and that enabled us to get into great detail on her initial body with the porcelain inlays and all the detail that Ito spent in preparing the body for his daughter.
Robert had a specific vision of a piece of alabaster pottery that he'd seen. The way that the light came through it and the way that the surface texture was.
It was luminous.
It was luminous and it was beautiful.
The doll body was a huge design exercise unto itself. This body is the one made by Ito. He's almost like a Swiss watchmaker. He's invested this with all kinds of beautiful detail. There's etching and filigree and engraving all over the body. And it just conveys the love that Ito felt for his daughter that he now is sort of conferring onto Alita as he puts her into this body.
This is called a berserker. It's a humanoid weapon system created by the Urm Technarchy.
This is Alita's other body, the berserker body.
A warrior spirit deserves a warrior's body, and you realize that this body is completely made for her.
Alita and her berserker body come from Urm technology. That is why Ito doesn't understand it. That's why when she finds a berserker body, it's unlike anything anyone has seen or anyone that has seen in 300 years.
Urm is the United Republic of Mars. Mars had been colonized. There were battles across the galaxy between Mars and Earth, and she lived in that time 300 years ago.
It has some kind of nanomusculature. It's probably electrically driven under the hood, but the actual actuation is much more organic. It's much more like a sort of living metal sort of muscle suit.
It's the adaptive technology of the berserker body. The shell is reconfiguring to her subconscious image of herself. I've never seen anything like it.
The idea is that she's tough as nails. You know, all of these things that look like muscle and sinew could probably take a bullet if they had to. Here we have a back view of the body, how the panels and muscles flow that Vitaly came up with. It's stunning. It's really great. And at the same time relates to the manga. She still has her signature metal side of her upper arm that has the ventilation holes in it. And, you know, we tried to keep it something that was inspired by some of her chromier bodies in the manga.
I'm a lot more touch sensitive too. A lot higher density of force feedback.
You can feel this.
Yes.
A big story point is that Hugo takes her hand and actually feels the touch receptors that she has. So we kind of came up with this contrast between metal surfacing and this kind of gel that serves as the kind of fat pad of your hand and of all of your different fingertips. And if I zoom in here, you can even see that the fingertips themselves have specific little touch pads.
99! On your left!
At the end of the movie, Alita's core is put into a special body designed for Motorball. And she comes out in the track with a number from her past. Because in her past, we have learned that she was soldier number 99. And that's what soldiers were. They were just numbers. But Alita's more than a number. But to recognize her past, she carries proudly the number 99.
I knew when I did Avatar with Weta that Alita would not only be possible, that as a character she would be spectacular.
I love it!
Every time we do these hero characters, we try and make them an evolution of our technology at Weta.
In Alita's eyeball alone, there's more geometry than all of Gollum for Lord of the Rings.
We followed Rose's performance and used that as our goalpost for what we wanted Alita to be doing in her performance.
The reason we choose performance capture instead of keyframing is in any digital character's performance, we're looking to bring life to that character. And there's no better way of doing that than capturing a performance from a real human.
The way the performance capture process worked is we had a number of cameras placed around the set that would record markers on the actor's physical body. Based on what one camera would see and what another camera wouldn't see, the system would interpret that marker and put it into three-dimensional space. Furthermore, it would know enough markers on the body to do what we call a biomechanical solve and create a skeleton to go inside a CG model to drive that CG model's performance.
This body, it has the power I need. I feel a connection to it. I can't explain. This could be who I am.
Alita is completely CG. Rosa Salazar is in a performance capture suit all the time in this movie.
It takes some getting used to. You're wearing a helmet with mic pack, battery, microphone, a titanium boom, two cameras. You're zipped into the suit. You're Velcroed in at the feet and you have gloves. So basically anything they could do to you to obstruct your process, they've done.
What changes it from being motion capture to performance capture is that simultaneously with capturing the body's performance, we are capturing the facial performance. Weta would interpret those images on a frame by frame, almost on a pore by pore level, to drive the facial performance of the character of Alita. Capturing the performance of an actress or an actor in a CG character, you need great people with great eyes to look at performances. We have our secret weapon at Lightstorm, Richie Bainham. Richie, who won an Academy Award for Avatar, will look at these animation passes. There's no lighting in the shot. It's a grayscale figure of Alita. And he will look at the details of the nasal labia fold, and he'll talk about that in very specifics. He'll talk about the muscles under the skin driving the subtleties of a teardrop coming out of an eye.
The real breakthrough with Alita's face was to take Rosa and track her onto a character version, an actor puppet, which is essentially a real-time visual representation of Rosa's face. From there, understanding, working backwards to what muscles are firing in which order and making sure we vet ourselves to say Rosa's performance is coming through on Rosa, then you can take and manipulate that and apply it to Alita. I think that's a big breakthrough.
Where am I now?
With me.
When you talk about something like representation of manga, we really wanted to be able to take this augmented animation hybrid and layer it against the performance capture.
In this particular instance, we did some motion capture, but it was too realistic. How do you blend in the manga of her flying through the air and all that stuff? So we decided to augment everything. So we made her jump a little higher, we slow motioned her, always to get closer to the manga.
When a stunt performer for Alita is performing, Rosa will be on the side walking through the performance, but giving us a facial performance that we can use as well.
She would go through a simple version of the stunt, and we would capture her facial, her head movement, and then we would use the stunties movement for her body. So you get the best of both worlds.
Rosa has a particularly interested in physiognomy. Her facial muscles and the way she manipulates them is very different than a lot of other actresses. And it was very important for us to try retain that all the way through. With Rosa, she has a very, very specific rhythm to how her muscles fire. I think that understanding which muscles fire in which order was kind of one of the real goals to bring Alita to life. And hopefully we've done that.
I'd give you whatever I have.
What are you doing?
I'd give you my heart. Take it.
To replicate all the details of her facial motion, we shoot facts with her to establish something that's an accurate model of her face and muscle movements and full kind of scope of emotions.
Facts is the facial action coding system developed by Paul Ekman.
He broke down all the muscle movements on the face, and we basically follow that system as our baseline for these characters.
There is somewhere between 50 and 100 poses that we typically collect. It gives us all the information we need to build like a facial puppet.
We had learned from Avatar the importance of incorporating the design of the actor playing the character into the design of the character if we wanted all of the emotion to come through. So we use Rose's face as inspiration to ultimately evolve Alita's face into.
It's all about this. If you can make the audience believe that that character is real in a tight close-up.
Does it bother you that I'm not completely human?
You are the most human person I have ever met.
Alita, as conceived by Kishiro, has got these giant kind of manga eyes on a very kind of heart-shaped face to accommodate those eyes.
We saw the look of her and thought, we've never seen an anime manga type character with those eyes. Ever since Astro Boy in the 30s, we've never seen it photoreal in a movie.
Alita, with her big eyes and all of the special effects, she still feels more human than most of the humans who are acting in movies right now. Everything she feels just put right on her face.
Yeah, right. So I'm 300 years old.
Sweetheart, you are.
Alita's eyes are an important part of her character.
The eyes, they're a bit of a yo-yo. We started with slightly bigger eyes than Rosa, and then we went to much, much bigger. And then we played with pupil size, we played with iris size, we played with moving them further apart, moving them closer together.
It's a little tricky because keeping the emotion intact as the actor intended, it can be a slippery slope. We have to strive on every shot, every scene, to try look back to what Rosa was doing and bring it to life with as much commitment as she did on the day.
You know more about me than you're saying. Whose body is this? Who am I?
Her eyes, even though they're much bigger in Alita, they are Rose's eyes just scaled up. Her eyes are 1.25 times bigger than Rose's eyes.
Her hair, it's very stylized, but we had to make sure that she could have this sort of unique look to her hair, but that it would still behave like real hair. So when you get to something like the Underworld fight, this is where it pays off.
What's the matter? My little toy doesn't want to play anymore.
We'll spend hours talking about the hair simulation. You look at Alita in the movie, you don't think that's not real hair. You think that's real hair. But that's not easy. And it doesn't always move the same way. When she's racing and the helmet comes off and there's wind blowing, all these different things. When we finalized the design of Alita and we stepped back and looked at it next to the manga, we knew we had kept our commitment to Kishiro to keep that character true to what he had created.
She's Rose's Alita. She's not Kishiro's Alita. He's handed the baton to her, as you do. When you get the right actor for any role, it becomes their version of the character.
When I first saw what Alita was going to look like, it was crazy. It was a very surreal experience for me because every pull, every indent, every scar, every crease, things I wish they didn't put in are there. It's like looking at me because every little nuance of my face is there.
One of my big thrills was when she looked at those scenes and she had laughed with joy and knew that that was her performance up on the screen.
That's so good.
It's amazing seeing Rosa's spirit, her light, come through the Alita character.
Rosa delivers a really nuanced, layered performance, and we're delivering photoreal digital performances on film, which is a new era of filmmaking, and I'm really excited to see that character on the big screen.
My hope is that when people are watching this, they sort of forget that she's a CG character.
She's just a character on screen. She's the same as Hugo. She's the same as all the other characters. Our CG can look amazing, but if our performance isn't there, it's never going to work.
It's Rose's performance. It's her and what she brought to it. It's her thinking, her emotions, and seeing it all finally come together has really been great.
You'd made the biggest mistake of your life.
What's that?
Underestimating who I am.
I think we've been able to create a seamless blend of live action and synthetic action in one single frame.
So are you stronger than you were?
Yeah, and faster too.
It feels more me.
There's the great story of a very heartfelt character becoming a warrior. And this is the opposite of that. This is the warrior who has to find her humanity. And yes, I've got power, but what do I do with that power? Even though she could be so many other things, she chooses that part of her humanity to put forward.
I do not stand by in the presence of evil.
And it affects everyone.
That was pretty intense, huh?
Welcome to Iron City's Sport of Kings, Motorball. Gladiatorial battle as you've never seen it before. It's machine versus machine in pitched battles to the finish. It is a proliferation of ferocious machines as weapons and techniques become ever more fierce. Let's see how the game is played. Rules of the game, number one. In team competition, two teams of seven compete on each side. First League standard, though in lower leagues there are three-team and five-team versions. Each team is allowed unlimited substitutions as long as there are never more than the initial allotment of players. Substitutions do not apply for players removed from the track on penalty. Cutthroat matches range from 5 to 12 players. No rules. Each player out for themselves. Larger variations have ranged upwards of 45 players on the track at once. Rules of the game number 2. In all league play, armor or pads are required. Helmets are optional. Propulsion systems are permitted, providing review and approval of league office. There's no limit to the number of wheels used. Players must have arms and legs. No pure-wheeled vehicles or tank tracks permitted. Weapons are allowed with the exception of projectiles. Projectiles include any type of gun, bow, spear, or anything not primarily attached to a player. Flamethrowers are limited to 6 feet. Rules of the game number 3. Any players on either team can field the motorball and move forward as fast as possible to try to score points. After gaining initial possession of the ball, the offensive team cannot try for a score until the ball has traveled one revolution of the track. A defensive player is allowed to intercept the ball or scoop up the ball that has been knocked out of possession, nullifying the requirement of one revolution. The ball carrier is not allowed to deliberately hide the ball from the defensive team. The penalty for doing so is for the team to forfeit possession. A relaunch is called and the player is sent off the track and cannot be replaced during the penalty period. Only a member from the opposing team can pick up the ball and play continues. A player must not deliberately injure another player. Only biological injuries apply. Mechanical injuries are part of the game. It's the dream of every cyborg. Do they have the skill, the killer instinct to perform on the world's biggest stage? Will they rise above or come crashing down in a fiery blaze on the track of tears? They may burn only briefly before they are smashed to junk, but by God, they will have their moment of glory.
Motorball is like racing. It's straight from the manga.
Very easy to underestimate a pipsqueak teenage girl until she goes into action. And then you better watch your ass.
On the outside, the sport of motorball can look like NASCAR meets MMA fighting. On the inside, it's a very individual sport about becoming the champion.
Almost like a NASCAR meets gladiatorial game. Your favorite high-speed action. And it's piped through all over the city. There's big screens all around. It's to placate the masses.
What is that?
It's motorball.
So cool.
Motorball is the preeminent sport of Iron City beyond the level that soccer is the preeminent sport in Latin America and lots of parts of the world. It's like it's the one and only. When there's a giant game happening, the city's quiet, basically because a giant chunk of the city's residents have gone to the massive stadium to go see it.
People are so obsessed with motorball and the stats and the players and the games. It's a favorite pastime.
You go out into a very complex racetrack with obstacles and tunnels. Jumps. A stadium with 400,000 people cheering in the stands.
It is a very destructive, a very violent game.
and there is a ball shot out at the start of a race. Competitors battle each other for control of the ball.
It's a game of possession. And throughout the track, there's different gates. As long as they're holding the motor ball, they score points.
It's a vicious game. You're allowed to hit anybody. You're allowed to make contact.
No one can have a gun. Everything is attached to their body. Maces, clubs. On the motorball, it has these places for fingers in the hole in case you want to swing it around, use it as a weapon. The motorball we took directly from the comic book. They had a scale, a size to it. They even had the weight. It has these gyros. They move independently. You can never predict where the motorball goes.
It was really tricky to take the words on the page and extrapolate out into a three-dimensional world.
Even though we conceived it, the majority of the actual physical track in the game, it's digital.
Take an outdoor sporting arena in any city in the world, put 10 of them together, you're still probably not as big.
It was meant to be a sport played for hundreds of years in this arena, showing a lot of wear and tear. It needed to be grungy.
We found a fantastic video of an amazing water park, and they turned off the water and they let a couple skaters in there. It just gave this great feel of the size of it. This was a much more immersive type of atmosphere. Rather than Daytona or an Indy 500, the track goes all the way through and it's like a mosh pit. We constantly tried to get them back together, whether it was pinching it down at times or having a curved track on either side. The fans liked the physicality of it.
Motorball was a combination of a lot of keyframe animation and performance capture.
The motorball scene was particularly challenging because we knew the real motorball sport with the pros is so high speed on the racetrack at 100 miles an hour. It's going to have to be computer generated because you just could not move that fast. The action, it was really too blistering and dangerous.
We keyframe stunts to be bigger and broader than is physically possible in the real world.
Whatever techniques you need to make it work, it needed to be fast and dangerous, but still keeping it real.
First league of play we see in motorball is the Champions League.
Robert really wanted to hang on to the Kishiro designs from the original manga. A lot of those characters look beautifully designed, each one with its own kind of style and personality.
These are not machines. These are being driven by humans. Athletes with multiple bodies.
Oh, crap.
Joshigan, black and gold power on the track. Going up against Claymore, a knight in shining armor. Juggernaut, his multiple arms picking up the ball. Adjacut, race car green, speeding around the track. Scaramasicus with his big blades like this giant snowplow. Kanuba, able to shoot out Grind Cutter that shreds anything they hit. Crimson Wind weaves with such dexterity, competing against people who are 4 or 5 times her size. And Alita, it's not the size of the man in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the man. In this case, the woman.
Alita does a cutthroat version. Everybody's against each other. It's just complete chaos, like a demolition.
You get all these different warriors with their different looks, people with bladed hands and all kinds of contraptions.
Hulking cyborgs, they got spikes and blades and saws and armor, and they're like nasty dudes. And then you have Alita who's like, I want to play motorball.
Here comes new process.
And then she's this tiny, compact little girl.
But Alita has this incredible strength and ferociousness to her.
She doesn't need all the accoutrement, and I really like that. All the guys are like, look at my bells and whistles, and she's like, hi. She takes them all down.
The origins of the manga come out of Japan. And an incredible artist named Kishiro, who created the mangas, I want to say 30 years ago.
Kishiro's original creation is something that inspires dreams.
The richness and the detail in the artwork created by Yukito Kishiro is what we're basing this world on.
I love the manga. I'm obsessed with it. I'm a huge fan. just sucks you in right away, especially the battle sequences where you have Alita taking down these huge, monstrous cyborgs. Every frame is an explosive action sequence. It's so wonderful.
It's an origin story of a young female protagonist who comes into this world thinking of herself as someone who is insignificant. And she comes to discover that inside of her is a hero.
あの、実際には戦前からあの、野良黒とかあったらしいんですけど、あの、手塚治虫がね、あの、戦後に日本の漫画をこの改めて創始したんですよね。まあ、結局のところ僕たちはみんな手塚治虫の孫子みたいなものであって、で、僕はもう生まれた頃にはあの、もう不幸の名作とやりたい作品がいくつもあって、あの、手塚治虫もそうですし、明日のジョーとか、そのね、忍者武芸将だとか、あの、そういう作品がすでにたくさんあって、で、僕はもう小学生の時にはもうきらぼしのごとく、あの、スターな先生方がいっぱいいて、で、絶対に漫画家なんかならないだろうな<笑>思ったぐらいですよ。で、昔に比べれば、あの、漫画家になることは比較的容易になったと思うんですよ。でも僕の、僕がデビューしようとした頃は結構、あの、SFとかファンタジーだけで、あの、書こうとすると、かなり難しかったですね。
Characters are so fleshed out, and it's just an encyclopedia for everyone.
成り行き的にそのサブキャラとして脇役として出てきたキャラクターなんですけども、それもボツになっちゃったんですけど、僕の当時の担当編集者だった富田さんが、このガリというキャラクターがすごくいいねってこう言ってくれて、で、このキャラクターを主人公にちょっと短編書いてみないって言ったんですよ。最初はね、ファンレターの一つも来なかったんですよ。 で、だから、どんなものか全然わかんないですよね。まあ、とにかく、一生懸命書くしかなくて。で、ある程度経ってから、最初の1話は確か、雑誌に載った作品が、人気投票、つって、ハガキがついていて、そこで、どれが良かったかみたいな、あるんですよ。それで、人気投票で確か3位に、 1話か3位になったんですよ。言われて少し自信を持って。で、一生懸命書いたんですけど、なかなかファンレターとか来なくて。で、どの程度受け入れられてるのかよくわからなくて。で、実際に読者の反応を知ったっていうのは、ガムのビジネスジャンプにおけるガムの連載が終わったのが95年の3月だったかな。その後に、ブワーってすごい勢いで、ファンレターが、
The first chapters evolved into 9 mangas. And then he went even beyond that to tell additional stories in this world.
The first thing I saw was the anime. They had done a short anime that was about 90 minutes long. And my friend Guillermo del Toro said, you'd really like this. So I checked it out and I got a lump in my throat at the end of it. I had an emotional reaction. I reacted to it strongly because my oldest daughter was quite young at the time. And I saw it as this great female empowerment story. We went after the rights and then I realized there was this whole rich series of manga books. So then we basically optioned and said, yeah, let's make a movie. Let's make a movie or a series of movies in this world with this character.
It's remarkable how universal the themes are that Kishiro wrote into this. And one of the things that always strikes me about Jim Cameron's movies are how universal the themes are. So this property that Kishiro created and Jim's ideals of what should go into a story are so aligned.
ジェームズ・キャメロンのね、ターミネーター、ターミネーター2、もう超大好きで、もうターミネーターもターミネーター2も何回も何回も本当に何度見たか分かんないぐらい見返して、で、ロドリゲス監督のデスペラードとか、マーチェーデとか、プラネットオブテラーとか、超大好きで、やっぱりね。で、まさかね、ドルズ監督がメガホンを取れた、ね、聞くまではびっくりしたんですけど、 驚いたんですけど、すごく好きな監督であるんで、すごく嬉しいです。
So it's a very interesting world with this cyborg technology, and it's readily available. It's not really like anything else that we've seen in movies. There's no bad connotation to being cyborg.
SF っていうのは一種の思想を表明するものだと思っていて、単に宇宙船とかロボットとか出てくれば SF かと、そうじゃないだろうと。それ以前の漫画ではサイボーグ009っていう篠森章太郎先生が書いた、でずっとサイボーグは悲しいものだと、早く人間に戻りたいと、そういう描かれ方しかしなかったんです、サイボーグっていうのは。ところが僕は当時は違うだろうと、サイボーグなんだけどじゃあどうしたら人間らしく生きられるのか、そういうふうに考えるべきじゃないかってい こう自分の中のこの危機意識というかテーマがあって、
It was important for us that Kishiro be a part of the process. When we first learned of the property, Jim made a trip to Tokyo to meet with Kishiro because he wanted to look him face to face and make a commitment to him that he would live up to the style of the mangas that Kishiro created in the film itself.
There was a writing process that went on through several drafts. I was working with another writer, Lita Kalogridis, and she brought a great energy to it. Then at a certain point, I sort of felt like we'd kind of hit a wall, so I went off and did my own draft. My own draft was 185 pages long, but it had within it the essence of a very simple love story. Romeo and Juliet love story. She's a cyborg, he's human. They're on opposite sides, but it's just too much page count. And I sort of thought, all right, I've hit a wall again.
It took Jim 5 years to get to a script that he was ready to make. We started getting into pre-production and just doing design work, including an art reel that we had created in 2005. At that same time, however, we looked at the landscape of technology and felt that we could maybe make a movie that Jim had conceived 10 years earlier, which was Avatar.
We got to the point where it was literally a coin toss between Battle Angel and Avatar. And we thought, all right, let's be really smart. Let's develop one system of performance capture to create these CG characters, and then we'll do Avatar and then Battle Angel, or we'll do Battle Angel and then Avatar, but we'll amortize our development for the system across two projects. A couple days before, we were going to do our first big test with actors, and so I looked at the Battle Angel stuff, and I couldn't find a scene that was just CG characters, as it was usually CG with human characters in the scene. When I looked at Avatar, there were plenty of scenes that were just pure CG. So we did it as our test. Somewhere in the process of bringing the Avatar characters to life, we sort of fell in love with Avatar. And so then it wasn't a coin toss anymore.
One of the reasons that Jim ultimately chose Avatar is because he thought that by doing Avatar first, the technology that we would learn on that film would benefit Alita in a greater fashion. In fact, having done Alita now, what we have learned is that doing Alita is going to have an even greater impact on the Avatar sequels.
I always felt like I'd just come back around to it at some point. Then with the wild success of Avatar and with things sort of going even farther south in the real world with respect to indigenous rights and climate change and environmental problems and all that, I thought, all right, Avatar is important. I need to keep making these Avatar movies. That might be the highest and best use of my time. And so I kind of gave up Battle Angel as something that I would direct.
When I first read, a good 15 plus years ago, that Jim Cameron was going to do Alita Battle Angel, I was a fan of the graphic novel and the character, and I thought how amazing his version of that would be. So we've been kind of dreaming about it and waiting for it forever.
And then one day I was just hanging out with my friend Robert Rodriguez. I'm walking him out to his car. He says, by the way, do you got anything? And it just went through my head in a split second, well, there's Battle Angel. And it's almost like subconsciously I had already decided to hand it off to another filmmaker, but only the right filmmaker.
He let it slip that he was probably only going to be doing Avatar movies the rest of his career, and my heart kind of sunk because I wanted to see Battle Angel. So selfishly I asked him, well, what happens to movies like Alita Battle Angel, like as a fan, like as a Comic-Con geek fan? I wanted to know.
And it happened in a split second. I thought I would let go of it for Robert.
Jim said, here, I'm going to give you the script that I wrote. It was way too long. And Jim said, if you could bring it down to a shooting length, you can direct it. On top of that, Jim gave Robert over 600 pages of notes for the story.
I did the same thing with Avatar. I did the same thing with Titanic, just learning everything about the history of Titanic. I think when you're building a world, you have to approach it from that perspective, that you have to create what the audience sees. I think if we're so lucky as to have this film be a success and we get to make some more, we'll go back and we'll feed on that.
Solid. Robert looked at the work and looked at Jim in the eye and said, I'm not going to rewrite you, because you don't rewrite Jim Cameron. I'm going to edit you.
I was like, oh, that's what I'm doing this summer. I'm going to take home that script and try to figure it out.
He said something like, this is written by a director. I can see the scenes in my head and I know exactly what to do. Just give me a few weeks.
What I was the most impressed with is how Jim really created his own story that you could see as a Jim Cameron story, the Jim Cameron perspective, his story chops, his emotional stakes. And yet when you would read the graphic novel, you would see how true it stayed to a lot of the things from the graphic novels. He took mainly from books 1, 2, 3, and 4 because he wanted to have Motorball in there. And not just put in for action's sake, but figured out a really cool Jim Cameron high stakes reason for it to exist.
Players, report to the line.
The amount of inventiveness that he brought to it, even in its script stage, really is what I latched onto.
He came back with a 130-page version. So I took that and I thought, this is gonna suck. It's gonna have all the good stuff compromised or taken out. And I read it in one sitting, and it was the story. It was the story that I had wanted to tell.
We were both shocked that we weren't missing anything from the longer script. We knew things had been taken out, but the core important themes, the character moments, were all there. And that told us that Robert was the right person to parent this child with.
It got onto a very fast track very quickly after that.
One of the things that Robert said to us is that he wanted to treat this movie the way he treated Sin City. He said when he was making Sin City, he made it a Frank Miller-style movie. When he was going to do Alita, he was going to make it a Jim Cameron-style movie. And in order for that to happen, he knew he needed a true collaboration.
I wanted to make something that resembled more of a Jim Cameron movie by grounding it more in reality the way he does, by really honoring his style, because that's what I would have wanted to see. I wanted to see Jim Cameron's Alita, not the Robert Rodriguez Alita movie. I wanted to see Jim Cameron's version.
It turns out that he's like insanely collaborative. He really likes the camaraderie of working with other creative people.
Spent a lot of time early on figuring out exactly the world, the look, the feel, and he was gonna be busy with the avatars, but he hadn't started shooting yet, so it was perfect. He was kind of playing hooky from that by coming over and seeing what we were doing on Alita. I would send him questions, and he was so generous with his time and his mastery of the material.
Robert worked with our designers here, so we basically just took them off Avatar and put them on Battle Angel for about 4 or 5 months. And Robert was blown away by the designs.
Fans of the manga will be really excited to see how many details are in there. Someone at Comic-Con asked, is there a Deckman in there? Yeah, the Deckman's in there. There's all kinds of things. And we take a lot of the design straight from the book. And the look of Alita straight from the book. That was Jim's vision since he was going to make the movie. And when I saw his artwork, I thought, wow, yeah, that's Jim always being very bold, forward-thinking, even when technology didn't exist to do it back then.
The original Battle Angel design development was something that was kind of legendary in the concept art field. We'd all heard whispers of, and we all knew that a handful of the top artists working on it. And to finally see it was great, and a lot of the DNA of that design work we tried to keep.
Robert actually had scanned the first three books, and he had highlighted specific frames that were particularly significant as far as making sure we got those shots.
In the first three books, there probably are 900 frames that Kishiro drew, and they're all amazingly beautiful.
The effort throughout was to kind of keep the spirit of the original designs. And as an example, Jim really made us watch the anime, actually, saying, like, Grishka, it should look like that. And he's going to look like a variation, but the sort of overall ape-like proportions of the giant arms and the skinnier, shorter legs and all that kind of thing, to the extent that the animators are able to pull that off.
I've had a little upgrade.
Robert was always very, very respectful of what I had written and of the world that Kishiro had created, but he's also not afraid to make it his own. And I wanted to give him as much space as he needed creatively, and I was emphatic about that from the beginning. He's been like a kid in a candy shop with this movie. He just charged off and started making a movie. I think I only visited the set once, and that was by design. I didn't want to signal to everybody involved that I was puppet directing the movie at all. This was Robert's movie from day one.
When we started getting into pre-production with Robert and doing design work, I flew to Tokyo myself and nervously met with Kishiro.
Kishiro Sensei, John Landau. Nice to meet you.
Showing him the cinematic concepts of the pages that he had once created, and it was a great reaction. And while I was there, I extended an invitation to him to come visit us when we were actually making the movie.
I also want to be a film director. 思った時期あったんですよ。ところが結局もう少し大人になってみると、あんな映画日本にいたって絶対に作れないだろうってすぐに気がついちゃったんですよね。そんなわけで早々に諦めてしまって、で僕は漫画の道に進んだんで、こういうね、実際にこう小道具とか作ったり大道具作ったりしてこう撮影してるっていう現場に、これ本当に夢のようですね。
When Kishiro came to Texas to visit our set, it was the first time he had ever been outside of Japan. And I led him out of our offices, and all of a sudden we were on our set in the world that he had created in Iron City. And as we walked down to the courtyard with the fountain and street motorball, just like he had written on the pages, I turned to see what Kishiro said. And a man of very few words said everything he could possibly say with a smile on his face.
When Yukito Kishiro came to set, I ran up to him and I wrapped my hands around his neck and I kissed him on the cheek. Like, I'm so happy you're here. And he is a very shy artist. So he was like, oh. But then he told Jim, he's like, Alita. So that was a really beautiful moment. I was really happy to have him there.
One of the commitments that Jim and I made to Kishiro was when he saw the characters come to life on the big screen, he would know that they were based on the characters of his manga. And we really tried to hold true to that.
Hello, how you doing? Good to see you.
I think Kishiro-san brought some gifts.
Ah. Waiting for this.
So Jim, this is his deluxe box, and he wanted to give this to you.
Fantastic.
With his, and for his gratefulness.
Fantastic. Oh, thank you.
And John, of course, for you too.
So. Arigato.
All right. Here's something.
Wow.
Two things, actually. So this is a signed print of one of my drawings from Avatar.
It's wonderful, it's wonderful.
And this is art from the movie, from the different artists. It says, with infinite gratitude for creating Alita Gali and her world, I hope that we have honored your work, your great act of creation, with our film, with great admiration and respect.
Thank you.
You are the sensei.
Thank you.
I think the audiences appreciate the fact that they get to visit a very manga world photorealistically, as if they were there.
If we are so lucky that the public want us to tell more stories, people can look to places we haven't gone before.
We've got a rich world to draw from that Kishiro has created. 9 books in the original series, and I think he's up to something like 19 books in the later series, which is called The Last Order. So it's a rich universe. I mean, if we're successful at this and people embrace her and embrace what we're doing, it can be open-ended.
People ask me, will characters like Ito come back? Will characters like Zapan come back? Quite possibly. They also asked me, will a character like Hugo come back? As Jim Cameron said, in science fiction, anything is possible.